Hello and welcome to The Appointment. I'm Pranjal Sharma. Joining me for a conversation today is Kiran Mazumdar Shaw. She is the Chairman and Managing Director of Biocon. Kiran, thank you so much for being with us on the show today. Kiran, we're talking at a time when you have made a remarkable success by entering the Japanese market. So why I want to talk about more of what Biocon has done. Let's understand a little bit about the impact and importance of what you have achieved in Japan.
So I think this is a landmark approval for us because, you know, it basically heralds our entry into a very, very tough and regulated market like Japan. And what this means is that this Japanese approval will open many, many global doors for us. For example, we are due to be filing in the US and European markets for regulatory approval of the same product, insulin glargine, in the coming few months. And, you know, the Japanese approval basically not only lends credibility to these dossiers, but I think the approvals will now no longer be a question mark because it will happen sooner than later. So that gives you the kind of credibility that you need as a company operating in the biosimilar space, that your dossiers are of high quality and that your product also is of high quality. So I think not only is it about US and European approvals that will now become a reality in the near future, but it's also about opening many, many more markets which were not accessible to us until we got a regulatory approval in a developed economy like Japan.
How difficult was it for you, for your team, to work towards getting the regulatory approval for entering Japan?
So first and foremost, we had a very good Japanese partner, Fujifilm Pharma. And mind you, this development is not a short-term development. This development has happened over the last 5 years. So I think Fujifilm Pharma really took on all the work that we had done in India and then with the product and with some of the development, and then conducted phase 3 trials in Japan in type 1 diabetics. And that's what led to the approval. So of course there was a very, very thorough review process of the dossier itself, the product itself. We've had many, many audits by the Japanese regulatory authorities in India. And I think we came through with flying colors. And this is really the culmination of a very, very strong joint effort between Biocon and Fujifilm Pharma. And I think that's what is very, very important to recognize. And that's what makes us very confident that we will be very big players in the insulin space as such. Because as you know, Biocon's first thrust into biopharmaceuticals was in the area of insulin and insulin analogs. And this is a testimony to the fact that we have the required skills and the scale to be big, significant players going forward.
What is the larger strategy that this is a part of? Where do you want to take Biocon from here? Develop markets, you have played a pioneering role in reducing the cost of oncology and diabetic medicines. Now that these new markets are opening up thanks to your relentless efforts, what does it mean for Biocon in the future?
So, you know, when we made that shift from our historic business, which was enzymes, to biopharmaceuticals, we had to have a strategy which really would get us focused on developing skills and expertise and scale in some of the chosen areas. We chose two very, very important areas. One was diabetes through insulins, because I do believe that diabetes is a global pandemic that's only becoming a huge challenge. And I think insulin therapy is a very key part of this particular diabetes management paradigm. And therefore, we believe that as a company where India was at the epicenter of diabetes, we felt that it was our responsibility to ensure that we develop affordable insulin and insulin analogs so that Indian patients could have access to these important, almost life-saving drugs. And then we could take it to global markets. And the second area that we wanted to focus on in the same way with the same rationale was cancer. because we clearly believe that cancer is a huge global challenge when it comes to access and affordability, because it is very well accepted and understood that immuno-oncology, where monoclonal antibodies play a very, very important role in cancer therapy, are almost unaffordable to most patients in the developing worlds. And therefore, we believe that as a company, we had it in us to develop affordable products for this kind of immuno-oncology applications, starting with biosimilar antibodies. But actually, we as a company started with a novel molecule, BioMab EGFR, for head and neck cancers, which was the biggest cancer in India.
Kiran, at one level, your focus on affordability is very laudable. At the same time, your focus on entering developed markets. What combines the two? Because you would not put affordability and developed markets together always.
You know, it's a very interesting question you're asking, because a lot of people confuse affordability with low profitability. And to me, it is absolutely not the case. I think when you develop affordable drugs, I think no market is isolated from the need for affordable drugs. If you look at the US today, there's a huge debate about the runaway pricing that has happened in the US with many, many drugs. And I think clearly they're of the opinion that biologics have had a field day to command unrealistic pricing, and the governments have paid for it. No longer is that going to be the case. They also realize that if they have to bring down healthcare costs, if they have to make co-pays more affordable, then it is about embracing biosimilars. It is about embracing drugs that are more affordable, and it is about embracing drugs that actually have a value proposition that makes it a rational decision for them to support such drugs. So I think this is a recognition and realization the world over. I think as a company, we are leveraging the cost base and, more importantly, the talent base that we have in India to deliver affordable drugs, which to us as an Indian company is still a very profitable proposition.
True. Kiran, you gave a very fantastic example of how affordability is not just about the developing markets, it's also about all developed markets. And linked to this is the fact that quality has to be consistent. You've been a pioneer on that front as well. First, let me ask you that, how would you like Biocon to be recognized globally as a affordable product company, as a healthcare company? What is your positioning? Because now your presence across the world is going to be, you know, enhanced in a very big way.
So first and foremost, I think I want to be known by a couple of hallmarks. Okay, one is about world-class quality, because I think quality comes first. Because quality builds trust, quality builds your name, quality builds your brand. That's the first thing I want Biocon to be known by. Secondly, I think as a company, we want to be significant players in global healthcare. And that's why you have to build scale. Okay? We have chosen two distinct areas where we want to be known, diabetes and oncology. And I think we also want to be known through not just quality products, but also we have some very innovative products which I think are game changers. One of them, of course, is my pet oral insulin program, which I really think is making good progress. And the other is our fusion antibodies, which I really believe are also in that game-changing space, where we basically look at immuno-oncology in a very different way, where you basically engage the immune system to basically kill cancer cells. So I think it's about targeted therapies that also engage with the immune system through a two-pronged approach,
right,
to kill cancer cells in a very select manner. And I think the kind of data we are generating right now is very exciting. And I know that these programs are going to make us a very different company.
When you say focus on quality, it's a simple word, but to reach that and to remain consistent is very complex. One of the challenges that the Indian pharmaceutical sector is facing is question marks on quality. What needs to be done about making sure that quality remains on the radar of the industry? is it just a buzz created by competition globally, or do you really think that somewhere along the way some of the players in the sector have not maintained the consistency that they should have on quality?
See, the way I want to answer that question is very simple. If India sees itself in a global leadership position, then it has to embrace that hallmark of quality. Okay, you have to do whatever it takes to build a high quality brand for India,
which usually means more cost and higher effort.
You know, it's a culture. Okay, it's about focus. It's about ensuring that you invest in quality systems. It's not necessarily about higher cost. It's really a mindset. It's a cultural mindset. In our organization, for instance, quality is a huge, huge focus for us as a company. We invest a lot in quality systems. In fact, very often our R&D department says you're investing more in quality systems than in R&D. And of course, it's not quite true, although we balance the two departments. But the fact is, we take quality very seriously.
And that's why the culture of the company is also, you know, it's infused with the focus on quality.
So I think there has been a sense of complacency in the Indian pharma market, pharma industry, where a number of companies are basically indulged in taking shortcuts, and now they are being found out. I think it's very important to use this as a time to rectify these shortcomings, because I think India must attain that symbol of quality. Because, you know, if you start relying on Indian products as high quality products, then I think we would have done justice to what we are capable of. But today, if you look at a German product, a Japanese product, a Swedish product, somehow you just assume that you don't have to bother about the quality aspect. But when you look at China and India, there's always a question mark. We have to go beyond that, and we have to make sure that we are clubbed along with these high quality countries as a symbol of quality.
But in many ways, you know, that issue is becoming redundant, because Indian pharmaceutical industry is now dominated by the global players. India has become a playground for global companies through acquisitions, through mergers, and that seems to be growing in momentum. So if you say, what is the Indian pharmaceutical industry, is really global pharmaceutical companies operating in India. So
that's not completely true, because you still have big Indian companies. Okay, you've got the Reddys, you've got the Lupins, you've got the Suns, you've got Biocon, you've got many other companies which are truly Indian companies.
Cipla. But at the same time,
Cipla is the biggest.
At the same time, you have the Abbotts of the world in India as well.
Yeah, but that doesn't matter. I mean, you know, as long as you have got big, strong Indian companies who can take on multinational companies, I think that's what we need to build our reputation on.
That's a great point. You know, it's building a long-term reputation, not just for India, but globally. One small point on the regulatory environment, and there is a lot of debate on patenting, on evergreening. These are issues being debated at WTO as well. What is your view on this?
I think India has a fairly good patent system. I think we need to articulate it better. I certainly believe that, yes, India has taken a stand on evergreening of patents, which I completely subscribe to. I think much ado about nothing has been made about compulsory licensing, because India has only issued one compulsory license, and I find that it's like a stuck record. Everybody who challenges India's patenting system only talks about compulsory licensing, only because there have been so many applications for compulsory licensing. But we must remember that only one compulsory license has been issued. So I think we need to tell our story better. I think, yes, patenting is extremely important, and India has come out with a very strong stand that it will respect patents. And I think that's a very strong statement. But we need to articulate our stand on patenting and the fact that we have respected patents in a much stronger way than what we are doing today. Because we are constantly being attacked, and multinationals have this habit of just harping on one or two case studies where they always kind of pick on India, saying that we have been weak. And it's not true, because the Gleevec issue, according to me, was a very, very legitimate issue which India has been able to stave off. And of course, it continues to be a sort of a thorn in their flesh. Secondly, I think the fact that we have only issued one compulsory license, and that too we had legitimate reasons for doing that, in the case of Nexavar, also seems to be like a stuck record, you know, used by the multinationals to basically attack India on its weak patenting system. But I do not believe we have such a weak patenting system. The fact is that we have a pretty good, legitimate, strong, fair patenting system, and we must talk about it more.
Kiran, you've been a champion of quality. You've created an industry almost single-handedly in the country. There are still a lot of question mark about Indian industry. We moved from allowing Indian industry to do nothing 25 years ago to this year. We are talking about the fact that, you know, certain industry leaders can get away with everything. Crony capitalism is creating and enhancing the trust deficit between business and civil society. Where are we today on this? How far justified is the fact that Indian industry seems to have let down the rest of the country?
So, you know, first and foremost, let me comment on crony capitalism, because this is something which is universal. It's not unique to India, okay? I think every part of the world is used to crony capitalism. And that basically points to a close nexus between the ruling political system and business and the business world, where they get certain favors.
And this could be at the national level and the local level.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, the point is that, yes, in India, in recent times, there has been a lot of concern about crony capitalism. And it is very evident that there is, you know, crony capitalism from the kind of mounting debts that you see, you know, talked about today, especially.
Undeserving industry managers got, you know, funds for projects that they could not handle.
Yeah, it's very clear. And what is even more telling is the fact that it's the public sector banks that have actually, you know, raised these or allowed these companies.
They have the highest NPAs.
Right? So they have the highest NPAs. And therefore, I think it's something that we have to take note of and make sure that we don't allow it to run amok. And this is what has happened today. I mean, today you can see that, you know, most of these debtors have got debt levels where it's very difficult to, you know, pay back based on their present businesses and their present business earnings. And of course, some, you know, people are being sort of, you know, unfortunately singled out, even though their debts in comparison are not that high. But the fact of the matter is that you've got to do something about it.
What can be done?
Well, obviously, there is now, the government has actually woken up and is actually taking a very strong set of measures, saying that, look, guys, we are not going to lend you anymore.
So using your sector's phrases, one is the cure for the malaise that we have, and second is the prevention to ensure it doesn't continue and get worse.
So prevention is very easy. You can say, you can institute a set of norms, and now I'm sure all banks have woken up to the fact that they've had to provide for huge NPAs, right? I mean, that was a very good thing they did, that they provided for all their, you know, their book losses, which was being sort of pushed under the carpet. And they've been basically forced to provide for all these huge, debts that they have taken on their books. But beyond that, I think it's also going to be about what is the cure. So I think prevention is easier than cure for the future. I think the cure has to be about tidying up these balance sheets. I think the pressure on all these big time debtors is quite intense.
The responsibility of industry leaders today to be more ethical, to be more accountable, to be more transparent, does the Indian industry has not really stepped up to those parameters and measures yet? Do you think it will happen now?
I think if you look at all the various measures being taken by SEBI, by the Companies Act, by various
Reserve Bank,
the Reserve Bank and many, many other quarters, is beginning to tighten the new noose around, business sectors. And I think there is going to be more discipline. I think there is going to be more accountability. I think there is a recognition today that, I must say that the Modi government has taken a very strong leadership position in attacking crony capitalism. Having said that, we also must ensure that everyone who is in this bracket of having these huge debts.
All willful defaulters should be treated in an equal way.
You know, I think that's what is important, that you cannot show some selectivity to certain groups of industrialists and then target some other groups of industrialists unfairly. So I think there needs to be some equity in the way you are dealing with this issue. And I think there has to be fairness in which you're dealing with this issue.
Prime Minister Narendra Modi...
And of course, the bankruptcy law is a big part of this.
Absolutely. Prime Minister Narendra Modi has been working very hard with chief ministers to improve the image of India globally as a destination for investment, and also for its own citizens, that India is a better place than it looks like. What would be your suggestion to him and the policy makers to keep the pressure up and to look at some constructive ideas on making sure that, the gap between what is promised and what is delivered is minimal?
So there are many, many areas where we need to improve. The first thing is, of course, we are an overregulated economy. And I think the Prime Minister is very seized of this. He realizes that we are overregulated. We need to simplify regulations and ease of doing business. So there is a strong focus on that. But it's so far not realized any tangible kind of benefits to industry. I still find it as regulated as before, and we need to really focus on that. The second thing is also about, the infrastructure. I think infrastructure has to improve dramatically to enable us to actually run our businesses more efficiently. The fact that we still have to generate captive power, the fact that, our logistics is so inefficient, all points to the fact that we don't have adequate and optimal infrastructure. And the third big thing is this whole PPP model. The PPP model doesn't work in India because the government simply does not live up to its commitment when it comes to PPP models. That is an area we really need to tackle in a big way. When we are trying to build our infrastructure under a PPP model, and when the private sector partner doesn't feel comfortable about the government sticking to its commitment that it signs off on, I think there is something to be said there. And I think the government really needs to give comfort to the private sector that they mean what they say. That is a big trust deficit that exists today in a PPP model. So I think these are some of the areas that you need to focus on. Apart from that, of course, for our own sector, I think, we've long talked about a universal healthcare model. And of course, the government is finally acting on that. But I think delivering on that sooner than later is going to be very important to boost this particular sector. And I, for one, believe that India's pharmaceutical sector is a world-beating sector. It is a sector that has delivered very strongly for us, whether it is about make in India, whether it is about innovate in India, whether it is about skilling India. I think this sector silently has been doing this over the decades. And we have actually become a formidable sector, which the world has recognized very well, but India as a country hasn't taken advantage of it.
Kiran, thank you very much for being on the show. And I'm sure that a lot of the young and new entrepreneurs will be inspired to follow your focus on quality and values at Biocon. Thank you so much.
Thank you.